Hello, everybody. Welcome to Profiling Evil by Mike King. Tonight is choir practice, and I am really pleased to be with you tonight. It's kind of a interesting day today. There is so much happening in the news. We want to kick back a little bit, talk about some serious things, but also hopefully laugh a little bit with you. And I just want to say thanks. Thanks for jumping in. Thanks for supporting us at Profiling Evil. And let's get started. I want to shout out to our mods tonight. Thank you so much for carrying the ball. The back office is here, so make sure you're shouting out to the back office and taking care of them. Miss Sophia, Maui Girl, great to see you. Free Spirit Prepping and News, Crystal G, Barb Nauman, nice to see you here. Barb's kind of excited for one of the guests tonight, so I'm glad to see Barb here. And folks, I want to just to remind you that today the next episode of Mapping Evil launched. This one is really an intriguing podcast. Go to your favorite podcast platform and get that. But Mapping Evil launched about 3 hours ago with episode 7, and it has to deal with a predator in Australia, but it deals with a serial sexual offender of children here in the United States, a person that I have hundreds and hundreds of hours of interviews with, and he was responsible for assaulting more than 500 children. Absolutely incredible demon of a human being. He died in prison, so that's the best news, that he never was able to get out and reoffend. But make sure you're jumping into that. And while you're there at your favorite podcast platform, make sure you're signing up for Profiling Evil podcast. We're having a lot of fun with that. Last week was an amazing interview. I hope you'll go back and watch that. And you can catch that on audio plus the premiere each week. And then, of course, thank you to all of you who support us through Patreon, through our channel memberships. And how can I not yell out to Mom's Jeans and Crime Scenes? If you haven't seen her channel, please go check her channel out. But thank you. She's tonight's Dr. Pepper donor, and she takes care of the back office. We're all drinking plenty of DP. And I know that a lot of you are going to complain and tell me all the reasons why I shouldn't. I just remind you, it is Dr. Pepper. It is prescription. And I can't tell you how much I drink because HIPAA doesn't allow that kind of information to be released. So with that, let's just jump into this. I want to invite my two special guests on tonight. First, Mr. John Lordan, and you know him from his amazing YouTube channel. John, how are you doing?
Great. How are you doing tonight, Mike?
I'm just doing great. And folks, John, we're going to talk more when the program moves on, but John has become a mentor to me, and I really appreciate all the help you've given me, John, as I've kind of glumped my way along in this YouTube environment. But let's bring on a guest that we both know, and I am just so thrilled to have back, Miss Ellie Green. Hi, Ellie. How you doing?
Hi, I'm good. How are you guys?
I'm doing good. Well. Yeah, John, you good?
Yeah. Yeah. And I just wanted to say, Ellie, it's a privilege to meet you. I was very moved by your story. I know we were talking just a little bit before we came on here, but there's such a soft place in my heart for young people that have something bad happen to them. And in your case, your mother has been taken away from you, but I think there's also a very deep reality in terms of there's a part of you that is now missing in all this. You're trying to get your life started. You're in very serious years in terms of aiming your future. And on top of trying to deal with all that, trying to get through college, trying to do school, you're having to be an advocate for your mom on top of all that. And just please know that that's so, as troubling as it is deeply inspiring to those of us out here that are looking for justice, watching people struggle for justice. And we really appreciate your strength and perseverance with all this.
Thank you. Yeah.
You know, actually, I think that's kind of interesting because, John, you had worked another case that really captured a lot of attention, and you found some similarities between that case and Angela Green's case, particularly in the surviving victims of these kinds of things, Ellie. And maybe you could talk a little bit about just that relationship and how that connected you with Ellie. And then I think everyone knows my connection with Ellie, but I now proudly wave the banner that I'm her surrogate uncle.
I like that he keeps changing the role. I remember it as grandfather, at least from the earlier episode. But yeah, there was, I know a lot of you are probably familiar with me from the Elisa Lamb story, and a particular with, you know, being on Crime Scene on Netflix. But coming out of doing the coverage on Elisa Lamb, I started having people reach out to me asking for help. And that was shifting things into a whole different direction. And one of those people, and honestly, it helped me change the trajectory of what I was doing in terms of my work, was Sarah Turney. And Sarah Turney's sister, Alyssa Turney, has been missing for many, many years at this point. And Sarah was, I don't remember if she was quite really decided on the fact that, you know, she knew people were suspicious about her father and his possible involvement with it. But I think she was still testing it. She still wanted to hear opinions from other people that she thought were unbiased and willing to take a fresh look at it. And that's essentially what she saw in me. So she reached out. She sent me all kinds of information. I did my usual work with analyzing it and trying to look at it and then making episodes based on that case. And we've been friends ever since. We've been in constant contact through all the years, through the ups and downs of her struggle, which is why I wanted to help get this true crime community kind of around you, Ellie, and supporting you in this effort, because it's a crazy, crazy roller coaster. I think Sarah would agree with this right to this very minute, as a matter of fact. And now being at the point where her father has been rearrested, now there are charges. He's doing all kinds of weird stuff in terms of different court maneuvering that he's trying to do, trying to kick it back to the grand jury. It's a long, long journey that she's been on. And I don't think your journey, you know, is going to be any shorter. So the best team that you can get together in terms of support, people that have been down that road before, people that can help you with different insight or different experience. I think it's really important to pull that team together. And that's really why I knew when I saw that story, I was like, we have to get Sarah as part of that team. Sarah has to be part of Ellie's team in this. It's also, Mike, honestly, why when I first saw Profiling Evil, I was like, I need that guy on my team. Like, I need to be able to call up Mike at some point and say, hey, Mike, I'm working on this case. There's this thing that I don't get, or I'm not sure about this police procedure, or I'm not sure about this type of analysis. I need your help with that. So the instant that I saw the email in my box, I was like, done. Yeah. What can I do to help Mike?
That's awesome. Ellie, kind of bring us up to speed. Maybe you can just take us back. It's been 22 months since your mom disappeared. But maybe while you're talking, folks will remind you that there is a story map at profilingevil.com that outlines all of Ellie's mother's case, Angela Green. And it goes through all of the case bit by bit, including the phone conversations Ellie had with her father and maps and graphs and all kinds of information. But Ellie, maybe you could just give us a high level revisit of the case and where it is today.
Sure. So the last time I saw my mom was June of 2019. And it was kind of a rough ending where we had a bit of an argument. And so we didn't end it on good terms, unfortunately. And then my dad told me she had been taken to a mental institution. Then later told me she died about 2-3 weeks later. So basically that rocked my world and that whole summer. And then I moved into my new house. I started my sophomore year of college. And I had a lot of stress and anxiety from just that. And then I decided to tell my mom's family since my dad refused to and told me not to tell anyone about her conditions or what had happened. So they started getting more involved and then called in to kind of check on, see if my mom was, how she was doing, if she was still there. My dad then said she was out for the weekend and partying with friends. And the police told me that, and I thought she's been dead for months is what I know. So then they started investigating and have done a couple search warrants. They did one that year in March, and then just one recently at the other home in Lawrence in December.
You know, Ellie, let me just stop you for a second, because John, I mean, this was one of the intriguing things to me. Ellie had never experienced a death in the family prior to this. So there was no framework of what should happen when there's a death. And of course, she's going through her own grief, and her father then indicates, hey, you know, this just happens. The cremations happen. We're moving on with our lives. But thankfully, this thing inside of her soul is saying this isn't right. And she continues to dig and dig. I don't know what your thought was when you first heard that story, but
well, you're highlighting one of the points that really hurts me the most in hearing Ellie's story, and that's she's now lost her mother, but because of the situation around this, it seems like her father's pretty much emotionally unavailable to her as well. I've listened to the tapes. He doesn't seem to be in any mood or method of grieving in any of it. If anything, you might say he's being defensive in a lot of it. The stories are changing, which is confusing you. So just in terms of your personal grieving process, like, who's there to help you? Like, who's there to help you through it? You know, did you have any other family members that really stepped up to try to help you with that, to fill that role?
Also, I don't have any siblings. So basically it was my friends and, you know, like my therapist and I trying to work through it up until I told my mom's family, and then they have really helped me. And my aunt even especially, like, reminds me a lot of my mom in the way that she, like, talks and give advice, even her voice. So,
yeah.
And then as far as family, like, when I come back home, I have my friend's family now that basically fills the role of, like, brothers and dad and mom. So
yeah sometimes that's what we have to do. Sometimes we have to put our own families kind of together. And I'm also really happy to hear you said a little bit of a magic word in that, and that was therapist. I'm happy that mm-hmm. you've got a professional that's helping you try to get through all this. I know another consideration in terms of Sarah's story was there was kind of a divide in the family, with some people thinking, yes, he did do this. Other people thinking, no, he didn't do that. Are you finding that as well?
Yeah, pretty much everyone on my dad's side doesn't support me, like, asking questions. And they're a good, he has several brothers and sisters, and they're a good chunk of them who had just, like, shut me down. So, yeah, I'm not in contact with a lot of them anymore.
You know, it's amazing though, because Ellie, you have a support group that is really quite phenomenal. The friends and relationships you have, the social media community that has stepped up to support you. But John, I'll tell you something. On Thanksgiving last year and Christmas Day last year, when I spoke with Ellie, there was no family that invited her over. She was staying with friends. And so that's really an indictment on a family too, that has forgotten to take care of some things, and probably some really powerful lessons that you're learning along the way, Ellie, about how to be a nurturer and a mom someday, isn't it?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. I think I'm just mainly disappointed that, like you said, like my dad's family did not invite me over for Thanksgiving or Christmas. And even though we did go over before all of this happened, and my mom would cook food for them and bring them gifts and help out. And this is kind of how they return everything, by not helping or supporting.
And these are people that were around you all your life, right? I mean, watched you as a child. And for them, I mean, you're still extremely young. For them to not be able to associate that memory to, hey, this is my niece. This is, remember her fifth birthday, remember her seventh birthday. Key it into all of those important family memories. I get it's a very tough place for them to think my brother might have done this. I totally understand that. But I think there is a line kind of in between that can be written a little bit too. As a matter of fact, I thought you did a pretty good job of that yourself in terms of keeping open communication going with your father. Yes. Were you recording some of his calls? Sure. Were you asking him tough questions? Sure. But I think there was still an openness to keep the conversation going, and, you know, for them to kind of remove you from that. That's really, it's heartbreaking. I don't know how else to say it.
Yeah. I felt like I was walking a tightrope for a while, walking on eggshells, trying to be respectful, but also like slowly pull information from my dad. So,
yeah. Where is it at now with your dad?
Basically, we just talk about rent, finances, taxes. Apparently we can't talk about anything else. So,
yeah. Well, you threw a curveball a few months ago, and you pulled up stakes and made kind of a academic change. Do you want to talk about that at all?
Yeah. So I picked up my stuff and moved to Colorado. So now I'm attending Colorado State University, and I'll get a double major in journalism and business, and also kind of getting into the film and television industry. So,
wow.
I'm loving it out there. I'm thriving. So,
for someone that has your experience and your story already, and to know that you're aiming in that direction, I'll put my word on it right now. Watch for Ellie Green and watch what happens. Watch where we're going to see her in 5 years. Watch where we're going to see her in 10 years. This type of experience and this motivating factor is going to drive her to do amazing things, probably in much the similar way that we've seen from Sarah. Could be telling her own story, could be helping other people share theirs. That's kind of part of what motivates me around this case as well. I feel like I'm watching my favorite superhero, like their early years that's going on here. So, yeah.
Thank you.
So Ellie, what is the biggest challenge you're facing today in moving the case forward? You clearly are having to make adjustments in your life to move forward personally, but how are you keeping this case alive and keeping it in front of police?
I still ask a lot of questions, ask for updates. I think it's just tough to not have a lot of evidence and go forward and not know like really where else to look, because we have looked in so many places, and like we're still trying to get more information. I don't know how much my dad will really tell me, since now he just says, but it was like she's alive, and now he's just saying I don't know where she is. And that's tough, because there are holidays, there are birthdays that come up, and nothing really changes, but those things still happen. And so, yeah.
And there's a birthday coming up in 3 days.
Birthday, April 15th. Yep, is my mom's birthday. So.
Yeah. Well, happy birthday to Miss Angela Green. And you know, Ellie, I spoke with the police department just a few days ago. They didn't want to share any information. I know that you try to get information from them regularly. it's one of the areas that I get so frustrated with, that we haven't come up with a better mechanism in a profession that I love to keep families informed, even if the informed is nothing's changed. And we'll continue to advocate for that. Now there's some secret agent work going on, and Ellie and I talk regularly, and there's some things that we still continue to look at and continue to work on. And we've had some successes and we've had some failures, Ellie, but it's been motivating, and we're going to continue at Profiling Evil to keep your mom's name out there. I know that you're going to. John, I'm going to put you on the chopping block here and just ask you to do the same.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. We're here to help. We're here to help raise exposure in any way. If it gets to the point where you need to raise funds for anything, yeah, please make sure that we know about that. We're going to help on that front as well. And the one thing, let me just run this by both of you while we have you here. The one thing that I've always been wondering about, sometimes in cases like this, they look for like the lesser charge, you know, some type of, at least we can get them in an interview room and start pressing around. The only thing I've kind of heard around this as a possibility on that would be the life insurance note and the kind of forged signature stuff. Has that ever been looked at as a little pressure point for moving things?
I'm going to take some pressure off of Ellie, and I'm going to just speak to the fact that law enforcement is aware of some of those things. They continue to look at those angles. Those are really interesting angles. The challenge that they face from a law enforcement perspective is that Ellie's father requested a lawyer immediately. So now he's the poison tree, mm-hmm. and anything to do with him, they have to be very cautious of. So that's why it's so important that you and I, John, do things like this, because we, as we appeal to this group of people, which will be thousands and thousands that listen to this, if you know anything, reach out to the Prairie Village Police Department and tell them. That's how these crazy cases get solved, when all of a sudden they're up against a wall. Because I guarantee the police department wants nothing more than to find Angela Green. Ellie, I know you want nothing more than to find your father, your mother. But anything that has to do with that poison now, because he's asked for a lawyer, everybody has to be very cautious about, and it has to happen in other ways to keep it clean and pure so it can go to court.
Gotcha. Gotcha. Appreciate the insight on that.
Yeah. Ellie, you have to come back. You have a lifetime commitment now. I want you to know that periodically I get a little text from the Dr. Phil show wanting to know if we're still talking, and I tell him that we are. So just know that there are lots and lots of people who think about and pray for you every single day, including this huge list of people that are texting and chatting in the group, including one who you have had lunch with and enjoyed a very close relationship with. So I'm so glad that you joined us today.
Thank you guys so much.
It was nice meeting you, Ellie. Thank you so much.
Nice meeting you too. Yeah. And all those comments and support are what keep me going, really. So,
well, if you're ever running shy, I'm sure you know who to reach out to. We'll both drum them back up for you.
Okay.
All right, Ellie. We'll see you in a few weeks. We'll schedule a time to get you back on and periodically do some updates. And thank you for always having, amidst some challenge, that beautiful smile.
Yeah. I try. Thank you. All right.
See ya.
Take care.
Goodbye. Well, isn't she a remarkable woman?
Yeah. Yeah. And I'm just telling you, mark my words, watch in 5 years, watch the good that happens on this planet. That's something that's really motivating to me is seeing these stories and hanging around long enough to actually see where they go. I mean, looking at what Sarah has done, it's mind blowing. It's mind blowing.
Well, and you know that in industry. I mean, you know the kind of people it takes to be successful there. And I think that's really a compliment coming from you. John, would you take a minute and just tell everyone about LordanArts, mm-hmm. your channel, and about John Lordan?
Yeah. LordanArts is the name of the channel. I originally started and I was doing kind of geek centric content like video game stuff and movie reviews. And I was just playing around with YouTube, you know, trying to figure out what the thing was. So when I renamed it from its old name of Geek and Dorks, I was like, I want to name it something that can follow me just in case it changes again. But it was through that experimentation, I started thinking about what am I watching? Like, what's the type of content that I'm watching? And at the time I was watching a bunch of, you know, like paranormal stories and kind of quasi conspiracy theory stuff, not super, super heavy into that, but some of that arena. And I was seeing a lot of videos about the Elisa Lam case, and they were largely disrespectful. There was a lot that was taking that story and pulling it into a paranormal context. And I know, you know, you watch that elevator video, and I still have questions about the elevator video. Just in terms of why it was released in that way and the makeup of it. But a lot of different people see a lot of different things in that video. So I was just trying to have a conversation about that and trying to bring it kind of more into an investigative mindset. Like, I'll listen to what your theories are, but then let's try to research them out. Like, you know, if you really think that there's an invisibility cloak that's being used in the elevator, let me look into that. Let's see where's the technology at for invisibility cloaks right now? Is it feasible that that was happening back in 2013 there? And through that, I didn't know that it was true crime. I didn't really consider that I was doing true crime in the initial kind of twist of brain scratch, but it was through things like Sarah reaching out, the Kendrick Johnson case coming to me, the Sandra Bland case coming to me. I think it might be a little irresponsible to even say this at this point, but, you know, I live in Minnesota and we wake up this morning and, you know, Duante Wright shot, in the middle of the trial that we're going through. I mean, so it was a pretty quick movement for me to see these serious conversations were worth having. Yes, there was tough things that we were bringing up, but in the comment threads, I was seeing things that I was learning from so strongly, including points of view that I didn't share necessarily. Some of the best conversations I've had on this platform have been with people that have a completely different perspective than me.
Yeah, there you go. And you know, that's really interesting because sometimes we want to surround ourselves with people that agree with us, and yet we really don't learn and evolve when we do we?
No, not at all. Not at all. And if you look at my channel, it's an evolution. It still is. I mean, even this year, like, I've got a new thing about how I'm trying to go about helping these cases. I've been figuring out some stuff. You know, for some reason, interviews didn't work on my channel when they were separate pieces. So now I'm kind of combining my usual research format and the interviews into a single episode, and that's working a lot better. I think you have to kind of constantly be evolving on this platform.
Yeah, so I want to come back and talk about that, but I want to talk about why I was so compelled to reach out to you in the first place. Of course, I know Dr. Judy Ho very well, and I knew and was watching her on the Netflix film on Hotel Cecil. Have had police officers who work Skid Row on the show to talk about the Cecil. I've been in that area many times, but there was something really cool that happened in that, and I want to call you out. And I don't know, have you seen the story map that we did on Hotel Cecil? Folks, we're looking at John's page and the hundreds of videos that he has here. And again, please subscribe to his channel if you are not. I want you to know, it's one of the first I subscribed to, John, when I started figuring out this YouTube thing. And I just love the way you do things. But have you seen the story map that we did on Hotel Cecil?
I haven't. The first story map that I've seen of yours, I actually went through the Angela Green one. And let me just say, I know how hard it is to compile that type of information, to pull all of it together and to put it in a format like that. Like, that's how I can tell this is a creator that is doing more than, you're not just reading a Dateline article and then turning on your camera and talking about the case like you're an expert. there's work that goes into putting together something like this, like we're looking on right here on this story map.
That's kind to say, thank you. Yeah, these story maps are amazing. And we were so enthralled by the case of Cecil, and from an investigative perspective, we just wanted to dive in deeper. And of course, I also have this love of GIS, geography and mapping. And so we went to our friends at Esri and just took advantage of all this technology to do this, to look at things in two dimension and three dimension. So I hope you'll go back and look through this, because we focus on the very things that you talked about. But the thing that changed my paradigm with John Lordan was that you evolved through the investigation. And that's a real difficult thing for some people who take a stand based on the evidence they have at the moment, mm-hmm. and then refuse to change. And I always reference Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, who the Sherlock Holmes figure, who said, it's a capital mistake to theorize before we have all the facts, because we insensibly spend all of our time twisting the facts to meet our theories.
Right.
And I watched you through this video. And again, my first intention was to go and watch Judy, and still I love Judy and follow her, but I was,
I don't think she got enough airtime. Let me just be clear about that.
I agree.
Yeah.
But what I was amazed with was I watched you evolve through this investigation, John. And that's why I reached out to you.
Yeah, I appreciate that. And it is an evolution, and it still is, but it was a very quick learning curve. Because there was other things I was trying to do with that series. I wanted to not just say, okay, I'm going to take a look at this and I'm just going to start at zero. And here's my understanding of the case. And that's that. And now I think that's it. And blah, 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 on to something else. I was trying to address the online conversations that were going on at the time. And there was multiple videos, multiple conversation threads. The theories were already solidifying, like in the public mindset. And I just kind of wanted to reopen those one by one and say, okay, I know that there's a big group of people that believes this particular thing. Here's what I hear you guys saying. And honestly, this is something that I learned back in my IT days when I would be doing business analysis, trying to help people develop solutions for problems. I'd have to analyze everything and then repeat back to them what I think that they were saying, so that they would come back to me and say, no, you got this one part wrong. Everything else is right, but this part over here is wrong. And that's really what Brain Scratch originally was, an ongoing analytical conversation, trying to move through all the different phases of this Elisa Lam story. And because of that, yeah, did I become kind of the Elisa Lam expert? I don't love using that term, but because I had dived so deep into all of those individual stories, you know, I was kind of the guy to go to if you wanted to tell that story. And that's what happened. I was being interviewed on podcasts, radio stations. I was popping up. Like, I had a friend from Canada. It's like, oh my God, you showed up on the news tonight. I'm like, you know, it was a really weird thing. It was a very fast kind of like all of a sudden this attention. And what's interesting about it is when you watch Crime Scene, you think that, oh, John was looking into this, you know, right when it was happening back in 2013. No, I didn't get into this until 2015. So yeah, the topic was still at that point, years later, so strong and being so heavily discussed that, you know, I put up the elevator analysis video, 200,000 people watch it. I mean, it's still strong. That's why Netflix was able to come 7 years later and do a feature on it.
Yeah. Well, and I'll tell you, Netflix, I thought, was very honorable in the way that they managed that film. It was factual. They took good care of the family, because Elisa's family undoubtedly could have been victimized through this whole thing. They treated it fairly and equitably. And I think that's really, really something that Netflix should be complimented for.
It was one of the first things I did. I got up really early that morning because I couldn't sleep, because I knew it was coming out. And I hadn't seen it yet. I saw it the same day that it was released everywhere. And one of the first things I did was emailed the director and just told him, thank you for telling her story like this and getting it out there. I thought they did a really good job in terms of bringing a voice to her. using her own writing, which is something I believe in. We did a video a bit like that ourselves, where we did like a memorial video with Aliza's own words. You know, is there other things in that series that were challenging? Yes. You know, the way that the series is edited, some people thought that it meant that Morbid, the guy that a lot of people went after, they thought that we were responsible for that. And then the director had to come out on a podcast later and make a comment saying, hey, we know that the people we featured were not responsible for that. So,
you know, I want to circle back and talk about Morbid, but more holistically in a moment. But we reached out to the Netflix team after, because we were doing a podcast with Judy Ho after the fact and had to get permission from Netflix. And again, I just, they were so very complimentary. And folks, I would just recommend, if you get a minute, go back to Profiling Evil Podcasts and look at the show with Judy Ho, where we talk through that case. And John, I think it would be great to get on and talk about that evolution sometime. Maybe we just plan that for one of the podcasts coming down the road.
Yeah, absolutely. You got it. You got it. I'd love to work with Judy at some point too. I mean, officially, like, you know, we popped up in the same thing, but I haven't had direct interaction. Her reputation precedes her. She's very respected in this industry.
She is an amazing soul, and she's been on a number of times. She's actually one of our guest co-hosts here. Mm-hmm. And I leveraged every ounce of favors I could to get her to agree to that. I don't know if you're aware, she even wrote the foreword to my book Deceived. And so she,
I'm not aware of that at all.
Shameless plug. Love it. Better you than me.
Thank you for sending that, Mike. By the way, I think we forgot to touch on this, but is it someone's birthday today?
You know, there have been some wonderful comments in there. I actually saw a comment from my sister and from my sweet daughter and from all kinds of wonderful folks. Yeah, folks, it is my birthday. You can tell because I've had all my old age spots burned off. My wife was wondering if I should put makeup on, and I said, I am what I am. So hippie, thanks a lot. I quit hoping that I would look differently at some point. And so to the back office, who I said, we probably shouldn't say anything about that. And they ratted me out anyway.
Yeah. First thing, I got on the call and they were like, by the way, it's his birthday. So let me just say happy birthday to you from everyone out here. Yeah. Oh, look at that. Yeah.
Jessica Shades is shouting out Dr. Peppers for happy birthdays. So
I have to say, Diet Dr. Pepper, that's like the best diet drink in terms of, does it taste like the original?
Yeah, no question. And you know, that's really the beauty of it. I jokingly, you know, talk about HIPAA and everything else, but because it's has the word doctor in it, it is a prescription for me. So it's something that I take very seriously. And I want you to know that so seriously that even when I travel overseas, I actually put a six pack in three baggies in case they explode on the plane and take it with me. So,
well, now you're giving away your prescription. You're not supposed to do that with HIPAA.
Yeah. So, hey folks, I hope that you'll ask questions if you have questions for me or John, because what we want, we really wanted a choir practice to become kind of a fun thing like it was originally intended to be, John. And I don't know, do you know what choir practice is?
I watched the first episode because I specifically wanted to understand what it is. But, you know, I know there's people here because I see some of my crew that's in the chat too. Please tell us again, what is choir practice?
All right. Well, JRJRS, thank you so much for that kind donation. So choir practice back in the 70s, the Los Angeles Police Department kind of is credited with this, but the officers at the end of their shift would want to get together and meet at a bar and talk about all the crazy things that happened during the shift. But to get on and say, hey, we're all going to Bobby's bar after work, didn't sound good on the radio. So they would just say choir practice at 7th and Broadway or something like that. And choir practice became this term for law enforcement getting together at the end of the shift just to kind of debrief, to talk about the ugly things that happen on a shift. and to laugh a little bit. And now the guy that drinks Dr. Pepper was never, I was always the designated driver for anyone on my squad that when this happened. But when we put Profiling Evil together, we thought we got to have choir practice and just bring people together and laugh a little bit and talk about some of the ugly stuff a little bit, because that's part of this mechanism. And, you know, think about it in your profession now, of doing true crime, you get to see the good, the bad, and the ugly. And it's been things that have impacted you personally. It's impacted even questions of personal safety. And that's what I kind of wanted to talk about with Netflix, with what we've seen in the last week with YouTubers who are going and harassing people at their homes, with YouTubers who try to do law enforcement's job rather than just report what's publicly available. And I'll tell you what, I work really hard to stay just in the lane that I have. I don't wear a badge any longer. I'm not a cop. I'm just, you and I are in the same bucket now.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and I think that's an important thing to realize is we have a role in this, but, it's never going to be like, I'm not the guy that's going to solve the case. That's not what I'm here to do. I'm the guy that's going to help raise exposure. I'm a guy that fields tips. Sometimes people won't call law enforcement directly. Sometimes they won't trust that it's Crime Stoppers for some reason. And sometimes I'll have to be a little bit of an intermediary step in that, getting the information from them, passing it to law enforcement. Sometimes there's follow-up questions, going back to them and trying to get those answers. But even for that, YouTube true crime has different kind of columns at this point. You know, what I do is I almost consider it like news coverage. And then you get someone like John Crimes, who is doing pretty much like documentaries, very artistic points of view, you know, stock footage, things that he's going out and shooting. He's telling a story just in a whole different way. But there's other verticals now, like there's kind of what I consider this drama, true crime thing that's happening, where people are using these topics and then using it as fodder for really promoting their own personality or something along those lines. So, a few years ago, Mike, I could have said, anyone that needs help in this community, give me a call. I'm there. No problem. Now it's like, I got to be a little more cautious, because sometimes I see other creators out there. I'm like, oh, you know, what they're doing isn't good. And sometimes there's people that get on certain cases and they just want to do that one case over and over. There's all kinds of different stuff that's happening around this. But when you find the good people, you got to throw your arms around them. You got to make sure that you stick with them. And those relationships that I've developed over the past 6 years, they're solid. I mean, these are people I could send a message to, pick up the phone, and they're there. They're there for whatever help I need or analysis I need. And they know it goes the other way too.
Yeah. I'm going to come to Ray's question in a moment here. I wanted to just shout out Brandy Bradford and thank her for that kind gift. And Sergeant Melinda, it's so good to see you back and up and going, Melinda. Glad that you're healthy, and thank you for that kind donation. It really means a lot that you're back up online. And the money's wonderful, by the way, but just knowing what you've gone through, Melinda, and that you're back and with us. And we've had that happen with a couple of folks, and I know that you have as well. Now, John, just a moment ago, a salty old cop from Long Island named Ray Kelly just popped up something asking what the most interesting case is that you had. And I just want to shout out to Ray. It's great to see your name pop up, Ray. So,
most interesting case. I see JRS is asking about the Lindsay Buziak case. The cases that resonate with me the most are obviously the ones where I've directly interacted with the family. And Lindsay's father came on. We did extensive interviews on the case. I saw the work that he's done year after year trying to raise exposure, putting his own security at risk. I mean, he's put up a website. He names names. that's one case that certainly it's just so hard to understand that you've got something like a real estate showing where there should be records around who's meeting up there, where are you going, what time are they supposed to show up. And then if you look into the interpersonal dynamics, the boyfriend, the boyfriend's mother, these strange situations that are going on, that one's a tough one. But honestly, I don't know why I can't, the Missy Beavers case, I don't know why we don't have that thing solved yet. I don't know why we haven't quite seen movement on it. Her husband actually commented on a video of mine a few weeks ago. And I was like, Brandon, if there's anything we can do to help, I'm here, man. Here's where you can email me directly. And I wasn't sure where his comment was coming from necessarily. It was kind of around all the crime scene Netflix stuff. And I don't know if he was honestly appreciating my work or trying to throw a jab, you know, thinking that I was part of the crowd that attacked Morbid. I really don't know. But either way, I was open to just like, hey, Brandon, like, I'm here to help. What can we do to help you with this?
Missy Beavers is an interesting case, and 12-step woman. Thank you so much. That's really kind of you to donate as well. Missy Beavers, you watch, and I've heard lots of different theories about whether it was a burglary gone bad or it was targeted. The challenge that I have when I look at that case is that a small group of people, perhaps a large group, based on how far the media about the morning exercise class went out, mm-hmm. are aware that she's going there at an early morning hour. Knowing that lights are on and to break in is less likely to me than some people who theorize it was a burglary gone bad. Plus, to dress up in that garb and go through all of that, especially if it's the vehicle who parks down the road, all of that becomes really suspicious and makes you look more closely to home than just an opportunistic kind of a crime. And I wish there was more information about the actual physical assault. We know that it was blunt force trauma, but do we know what else happened?
Well, I'm not even sure about that necessarily. I found an analysis from the FBI. You know, they release their crime statistics publicly. And I believe I found that occurrence. They have it classified as a gunshot death in their data. But that, to your point, yeah, why don't we know this? Why hasn't that information been put out so that we know what we're looking for? But Mike, let me ask you, because now I finally have an expert I can run this by. Is that a costume or is that legit police gear?
Yeah, I think it was, I would put more toward the costume. Number one, because of the way it fit.
Yeah.
The looseness of it, the individual wearing it, or it's something that's too large and they've tried to put it on. But that all is pretty darn wacky. I mean, it's a really intriguing case, and like you and a few other YouTubers, it's been really interesting. And I know that Tim in our back office has spent some time looking into that and trying to get more and more information. And, you know, this is an area, John, where, again, I become a little critical of my own profession. And I make no bones about it that I think that my profession was a pretty noble profession. And we haven't evolved as a profession when it comes to social media. Social media is not about a Facebook page or a Twitter page where I can say there was a burglary at 12th and Vine.
Right.
Social media today and a social media presence is about getting out. And I was just thrilled with, I believe it was Jacksonville, Florida, just a few weeks ago, that ran their own podcast about one of their cold cases. Why on earth isn't every single police department across the country reaching out to their community and tell them about your case? Keep it alive. Tell them the things that you need help with that the public can solve, and remind them, do not go and investigate this, but share it with us.
We're just
not evolving.
Yeah. And you're making a really good point, because the media, I think the kind of traditional approach has been, well, we'll put out a press release and it gets picked up by our local publications, and maybe the radio station mentions it. All the newspapers put out this little two-paragraph version of our press release. Maybe it'll get on the nightly news on our local channels. But if you look at who consumes those sources, particularly like the nightly news source, that is a way older demographic. A lot of people that are retired that are staying in their homes as it is. Is that really going to be the striking point for moving your case forward? If it's a college student that has been killed? Probably not. So now we need to think about the avenues of media and how they're suited for the type of audience we're trying to reach. A podcast, if it is a college student that has been killed, perfect medium, perfect medium. And it doesn't go away. Even if you get something on the nightly news, it's there for 5 minutes. Maybe that local station will put it on YouTube as well. They'll put up a little, you know, few minute version. That's helpful, but not all of them do it. A podcast, you put that thing up, it's not going anywhere. Anyone that's interested in that case, months, years down the road, they're going to find that information.
No, you're right. And, you know, you think about the evolution of technology for law enforcement, forensics alone with DNA and the introduction. I mean, in the 70s, when I started in law enforcement, you know, we hadn't heard about DNA. We were still pretty lucky to catch people that didn't realize they could wear gloves and get away with, you know, with crime. But we started seeing this evolution of DNA, and now it's demanded. Well, just a few months ago, I brought on some friends that do nothing but explore the dark web, and they have to do it in conjunction with law enforcement. But they fight with law enforcement to even let them come in and help to say, let's just help you explore the dark web. Right. We just have to get better at evolving and being able to ask for pieces of information that we want some help on. You got to still keep a few things close to the vest, because those are the things you're going to trip up a suspect on when you interview them.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And Mike, it means a lot for me to hear someone like you talk about this, someone with your experience, to basically be beaten on the same drum that I've been beaten on for years at this point. There was a conference, the American Association, ASOC is what it's known as, but it's one of those cold case groups where investigators get together, they'll take on a cold case. We did a little talk there with the guys from Crawl Space and Mike Morford and myself on a panel. And we were trying to engage that, trying to, because now we had a room full of investigators and law enforcement and, you know, people that are working these things. And we were trying to raise that question about how can we help you guys better? How can we build some kind of mechanism for maybe you need help in this particular area? Like, let's say it's a case from the East Coast or, you know, Massachusetts. Well, Crawl Space, that's where those guys are from. They know that community. They could do live events. They could literally get groups of people together in the location to talk about that case, stream it, do a podcast off of it. All of a sudden that thing's on the web. It's going everywhere. There's a connecting piece that's missing. I thought at first, because I used to be an IT guy, so at first I'm like, well, it's a website, right? It's just a website where law enforcement can go and they're saying, we need this type of social media help. And then it routes to the right creator or something. But it's more than that, Mike, because there's this education component that you're touching on. Law enforcement needs to understand what the benefits are and then how to engage it and how to use it. And one of the things I was bringing up just in terms of YouTube true crimers, we're not all created equal. We all do things very different ways. How do they know to avoid a pitfall of like, oh, I wound up sending my case to this drama channel and now they're harassing the family, you know?
Yeah. Well, and maybe one way to avoid that is then tell the story yourself, but don't keep it quiet. And, you know, that's what these families need, is somebody that's still beating the drum for them. And that's exactly what you do. I just saw this great comment I have to put up by Edna B. Who don't know John in the true crime world? He's the king. Yeah. So I think that's awesome. So King John, Brady Huey. I loved your review of Brady, and I thought as I watched that, I was bouncing up and down saying, oh, I wish I could sit there and have him just ask me some questions. Any questions you have about John Brady?
The Bradley Huey case, the case Bradley that Huey, I just did? Yeah. Well, it was one of those, because when you were talking about so little information coming out about the crime and how do we help in that case, that that case is one of the perfect examples. We think it's a shooting. We know it's multiple wounds. Family doesn't even know how many. Family doesn't know caliber, type of weapon. You know, we think that he was probably going out to find some marijuana, and that's about all that we know about it. Why is he in that particular area? It's just one of those cases where when I looked at the coverage, I was like, how am I supposed to cover this? Because no one, and this is an unfortunate thing about our current state of major media, no one took it up for, hey, there's a story here. There's a real human story here, and we're going to tell it. So all the coverage was basically just the little 2-minute blurb, you know, paragraphs that I was talking about. Nothing even explained who he was. Like, you know, what type of person is this? What is he into? What were his likes? What were his dislikes? What was his lifestyle? Did he live a risky lifestyle? There's even things where I'm wondering, you know, we interviewed his mother, and I'm wondering about, well, he's driving that kind of car, but he's selling stuff at the flea market. You know, that car sounds like it's a little fancy. Is it possible that he's selling other things at that flea market? Is it possible that maybe this wasn't, you know, him going for personal use marijuana? Maybe it was some type of major score or something like that. But those components, especially if we're asking the public for help, they engage different social circles. You know, if you're someone that's in the drug scene and you've got friends that are connected and you're like, oh, I know some people that live in that area, but he wouldn't be going there to score, you know, a pound of marijuana. He's just going for a bag. So that's not the right type of dealer. It affects the social view of that and the people that are talking about it. And that's what you're trying to engage, is help from them. So,
yeah. Well, so when maybe this is one that we could jump on together with sometime and talk through, or this becomes the kind of thing where maybe we just do it together, because you had a lot of really interesting questions that that I really loved. You know, questions surrounding, why are his tennis shoes missing? Why is his car dumped in a different location and burned? And I loved the fact that you really, I think, made some really smart assessments on the fact that a suspect, the motivation isn't stealing a car. Otherwise, they wouldn't take that and dump it. Now, moving from one location to another, places, generally what you see in a situation like that is people returning to where they originated, where they live, and dumping the car. And of course, burning it destroys evidence and resolves a lot of problems, especially if there was blood residue in the vehicle or something like that. But
I mean, we weren't even sure, like, was he shot at that location? Like, we're debating, you know, the family's still debating, was he shot somewhere else, put in his car, they rolled him out of the car at that location and then took off from there. And information like knowing if there was shell casings found at the scene or something like that would help kind of clarify the public perception.
Unless, you know, the shell casings fell out when the body was dumped out. It's really right on it. And this leads to something I talk about a lot on my channel, John, and that is that we have to realize that there are multiple crime scenes in a case. There's this initial contact site where these people come together, where the plans are formulated, where even if the victim doesn't know they've come together, there's been a connection made. Mm-hmm. And then you have this location where the crime occurs, and the crime actually could be in several locations based on what the fluidity of the crime is. And then you have disposal sites. And in this case, disposal site might be the street corner where Bradley's dumped. Right. Or it could be the disposal site of the vehicle where it's dumped and the vehicle's destroyed. But all of them become very symbolic about the personality of the offender. And this is something that sometimes in law enforcement we miss, is that we have to look at the behavior of why was the vehicle selected where it was. I mean, why was Bradley dumped there? Mm-hmm. If you're simply dumping someone to get rid of things so you can do a do-over, a street corner is not the place to do that. You know, what was the reasoning behind that? What was the risk that they take by dumping someone there? I mean, how many people are walking dogs at night or anything else? You think about the elevated risk that these offenders are willing to take to do things. And then that leads us to think about how organized were these offenders, or how whacked out were they at the time things are going on. So all of this starts to paint these really cool pictures of who the offender is by personality.
Absolutely. And just to your point, knowing that they were going to go torch the car, why wouldn't they have kept Bradley with the car?
Excellent point. Absolutely. Yeah. And if you're going to stage something, there's a lot of ways you could stage that guy's death. So that's going to be really interesting. We should explore that. Well, I'm going to just give you one of the most perplexing things that's happened to me in at least a week. And I want to see what your thoughts are on this.
Okay.
Because my sweet little granddaughter sent me a note while we've been on this chat tonight saying, yeah, but you haven't figured out who stole my bicycle a couple of days ago.
Uh-oh.
And thankfully we have this world in which we live in where we have lots of CCTV, and you actually covered a case just yesterday or today, I think, on cameras that were removed, but one was still there. But I want everybody to just in the chat room, help me solve this case for a beautiful little 8-year-old who had her bicycle stolen a couple nights ago.
Oh my goodness.
Yes. So, while we're watching this, so there's the suspect riding away on her little bicycle, full grown man on her little child bicycle. Now, folks, if you live anywhere in northern Utah and you know the bad guy that stole Caroline's bicycle, I will buy you a case of Diet Dr. Pepper to help me solve this crime. But John, tell me in your mind, who's the guy and what's the motivation for a full-grown man to sneak around in people's backyards and steal a little girl's bicycle?
Oh, it's obviously it's a thrill job, right? I mean, he got such a rise out of taking the bike. He couldn't wait to ride it. It must have been a very cute bike. What color was it?
Well, back office, help me out, because I'm typing a note here, because I also want to just share another example from that same, a white bicycle.
Yeah, I mean, I'm seeing Winter Garden say to sell the bicycle, but for a kid's bike, would it be maybe to steal it to give it to someone in his own family?
Yeah, that's what I'm wondering.
That's kind of what the first thing is
Dad said it was a white bike and Mom has just clarified that it was a pink bike. So
we got to go with Mom on that.
Yeah. There's no question. Who knows what color.
I would think it was probably to give the bike to someone else. I don't know. I mean, a kid's bike for money. Yeah. I guess you could sell anything. You could fence anything. That is heartbreaking. That is really, that's terrible.
So now at this same house, because I want to just end with you talking a little bit about the Cloud case from today.
Yeah.
Because I thought it was just such a great reminder. Folks, if, you know, we talk a lot about what people can do to minimize their own risk, John, and cameras to me are one of the cheapest, easiest ways to solve a problem. And while you're talking a little bit about that case, I'm going to have the back office pull up Zero the Hero, because every once in a while, the bad guys lose when it comes to cameras. And that's the same house that had the bicycle stolen. Another perplexing case that we immediately called the Real Time Crime Center, which I had a hand in building, and turned that over and put the wheels of justice on. In that particular case. But tell me about the Cloud case. I think that's an interesting case.
Yeah, it's one that we called Cloudy Evidence. And this is a story about a former senator from Arkansas. Her name is Linda Collins Smith. And it's interesting because in the lead up, you kind of hear about her relationship with her husband and a messy divorce that happens. Her son doesn't hear from her for a couple weeks and decides that he's going to go check on his mother. And when they pull into the driveway, They find a tarp that's in the driveway that's covering up a body, and his mother is out there.
And it's stinking.
Yeah.
It's been there for a while.
It's been there a while. I think it's at least a week. Yeah. At least a week that it's sitting out there. So investigators start working the case. Of course, they're looking through the house, and they learn that she had an assistant that worked with her as well, Rebecca O'Donnell, I believe. And as they're looking through the house, they notice that there's one security camera by a company named Arlo. And they find the camera and they're like, okay, we're going to contact this company and see what's up with this. Well, there was multiple cameras in the house originally, but killer decided to go through and remove all the cameras. But they missed one. And that one is basically what unravels the whole thing. So they contact Arlo.
Awesome.
Yeah. And that's one of the great things about like the footage that you just showed. A lot of the systems we have nowadays, I think Nest also sends it right to the cloud. So, you know, it used to be, I used to manage a store back in the 90s and we had security systems, but there was, we literally had this giant safe where the tape recorder was like in this safe, because they knew even back then crooks are going to come in, they're going to want the tape, and we had to lock it up so they wouldn't be able to get it. Yeah. Nowadays, we've got the cloud. So, you know, all those doorbell cameras and all that kind of stuff just goes right up into the internet. So they contact Arlo and they find that the assistant, Rebecca O'Donnell, is seen in several different clips. She's got blood all over her. She's carrying a knife. She's taking the cameras down, removing them.
Yeah, but wasn't the blood from just carving a chicken?
Right. Yeah, that was her excuse.
Isn't that something?
Yeah. So the cloud is backing you up. And I mentioned in that episode, and I'll mention for everyone that's watching here too, look into those cameras, get one that has some mechanism of sending those images to the cloud. And so there's some of them that you have to pay for, like little service fees. There's other ones where you don't have to, and they're still going to the cloud as well. So do a little footwork and make sure you've got some good cameras. Keep yourself protected.
Yeah. And I will just echo that. I have cameras all around my house. They are inexpensive and a great way. Even things like Ring now have the neighborhood program where they share information with the local police department immediately. Hey, and I don't know if you noticed, but two wonderful folks stepped up, and this was not the purpose. Brandy Bradford, thank you so much. I go by Papa, although they did want to call me G Daddy at one point, but I pushed for Papa. And then I want to thank Jeff W. too, who also stepped up to get Caroline a new bike. That's awesome.
Look at this community.
Isn't it amazing?
Yeah.
And now to tell you what a neat family that is, they also have this incredible black Labrador that when this porch pirate came and tried to steal a package, watch what happened.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
And that's my daughter going out to get the package. Zero the Hero actually made national news on Fox television for months. They would pop that up on their website and he was on the evening news. And this is for anybody that's watching, that's the meanest dog on the planet. He is ready to jump into action.
Yeah. Can we get a little fund going for Bones for Zero as well? Yeah. He earned it on that. I can't believe that package comes flying out like that. And Mike, maybe we can get a little sticker that they could put on their house to say that, you know, profiling evil is protecting this property.
Interesting. Kind of like the little alarm things out on the lawn.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's do that.
Ours looks like a lollipop. So maybe we could get yours and put it up. So, Mom Jeans and Blue Jeans, thanks again. You're in Crime Scenes, I mean. I don't know if you've ever watched her channel, John, but she does such a great job. and has been such a wonderful supporter of us. And I just really appreciate that. And I got a note that says Zero's getting old enough that maybe we should be asking for the cemetery fund, because that's a step for that poor dog, but he still makes it year after year. He sits up at the cabin and enjoys things. But
he looked pretty spry. Looked like he's got some spunk left in him.
Yeah, he's got enough in him. Yeah, I think he thought there was a treat at the end of that rainbow. Not a bad guy, but but I'm going to give folks a couple of minutes in case anybody has a question for John or me. And John, I hope you don't mind staying just a moment longer.
No, no problem. I just wanted to say hi. I see Misty Kate in there. And of course, retired Sergeant Melinda, always good to see you and happy to see you back in this community. She supports so many different creators.
Wow. Amazing.
Yeah. And she's boots on ground. She's helping these cases as well. She's an amazing person. We're really happy to have her back. Also, Brandy Bradford. Always nice to see you. I'm seeing all kinds of names I know here. Amy Bumble's here. Cat Jersey Shore. What do you think, guys? I think Mike needs to come on an episode of Brain Scratch. I think we got to do an episode together.
Oh, I'd love that. Anytime.
Yeah, yeah. I really loved your insight on Bradley's case, and we should do that. I'm gonna make that happen. We're going to have Mike on really, really soon. Babble Froggy, hello there. It's nice to meet you too, Linda.
Hey, Barb wants to know what kind of camera to get, John. I've always kind of strayed away from that, waiting for one of them to step up. But do you have a favorite?
You know, the one I like, if you're only getting like a doorbell cam, I like Sky Bell. It's a smaller company called Sky Bell, and I like them because there is no fee. I mean, it's the same thing. It's going right to the cloud. It's just got a great wide angle on it. I mean, if you're driving down my street, you're already on camera. So yeah, Skybell, if you're going just for the doorbell. If you've got someone that's a little handy at home, you can actually install it yourself. I did mine myself. So
yeah. Louisiana girl wants to know if we'd be interested in covering the strange disappearance of Corey Gauthier, LSU co-ed. So, John, one thing that we have, I don't know how you take some of these, but we set up something called the evidence room. And so people just go to profilingevil.com/evidence room, and there they can enter information in about a case. Those who put more information and valuable content, you know, don't just put in, hey, you ought to look into this.
Yeah.
Give us something to start with. We really try to consider those. And if we can't get them into a show, we actually make sure that we either forward them to the police department, or we have something called the BOLO, Be on the Lookout, a newsletter that we do. How do you handle those kind of things?
Yeah. If you go to LordanArts.com, we actually have a suggest a case link, and it works in kind of the same way. Just asks about the basics of the case. We have, of course, the main shows that I do, but Christy Arnhart, who works with me, she's a associate producer, co-host on Case Cracked for the ending segment where we kind of talk with each other. She also has a TikTok that she's doing. So especially for missing persons cases, if I can't do a full-blown Searchlight episode on it, we'll make sure that Christy releases it on TikTok, a little 1 minute, very concise. Here's the basics of the case. Let's get it out there and help raise exposure.
Oh, that's awesome. Now, I always just go to Lordan Arts and then feed from the tree there. Do you have preferential places that you want people to look you up?
Lordan Arts is the best place. You can get to everything from Lordan Arts.
Yeah. And thanks for that kind donation. And Melanie B says, get a hold of Critical K. So there you go. You got some, you got a tip there. Christian. Okay. Andreotio case or something like that. So thanks, Melanie B. That's great. So John, what's the long range focus for you right now?
Right now it's really, I'm continuing the shows, but I've been doing something that different this year. I'm considering it next steps, just kind of once again, moving things forward from where true crime has been on YouTube. What's the next thing that I can do? Of course, making donations has been pretty much a staple of my channel for a long time, but we had one case in particular that we covered where we brought a brother on for the victim's name is Margaret Sweet. And this guy was just overwhelmed, trying to deal with keeping the exposure raised for his sister's case, keeping in touch with law enforcement. There was no real online presence. The articles were starting to disappear from all the news sites. So I kind of caught the case just at the right time to, you know, use the Wayback Machine and tried to pull some articles back and put together the story. I had the brother come on and I asked him towards the end of the episode, I'm like, have you thought about putting a website together or something? Because this information is all disappearing at this point. And he was like, I really need to do that. And I'm going to do it. I'm going to get it on my list. And I had already basically bought the domain name. I started building the website that morning. I finished it off that afternoon. So that was kind of the big thing that for me this year so far has been the perfect example of that next steps mentality, which is, yeah, I'm going to help you raise exposure. We're going to save all the information we can, but we've also bought, you know, 5 years of this website. I've already put it together for you. It's ready to go. I just need some pictures of your sister to add to it. And he got very, very emotional. I got emotional as well. So that's really my long-term kind of target right now is helping these cases, but really trying to affect some form of change in them.
That's fantastic. Congratulations.
Yeah.
And I just noticed a new member, Jeff W., joined in. Well, I can't thank you enough, John. I mean, this was not only educational for me, it was a lot of fun tonight. And I really enjoyed it. And you know, I think about, the part of the country you're living in right now, the world is watching every single day. Law enforcement has episodes of horrible mistakes. But I just keep reminding people that the majority of police officers out there really do believe in this thing, protect and serve. And I've known the chief in Minneapolis before this chief and the one before that, and have had the privilege of working with people in that organization. And I know that some of the mistakes that have been made are not reflective of everyone. But I keep reminding people, we've just seen the prosecution side now. Now we got to weigh what the defense says and then make a decision. May not change any of our minds, but the process that we believe in this country is that we hear both sides of the story before a decision is made. And so just remind everybody to kind of put yourself in the seat of a juror and try to remain impartial as the evidence flows and then make a decision. Again, may not change anyone's opinion, but
yeah,
that's the process we believe in.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And being open to change your position, ultimately, that's what we're hoping for from a lot of people. There's a lot of people that are looking at this situation saying, you know what, we need change. We need things to be different. So if you're expecting that of other people, I think it's only as fair to expect that of yourself as well. Give yourself that ability to look at yourself and say, can I do things different? Is there a better way?
Well, folks, John Lordan, Lordan Arts, please go to his channel and subscribe. I count him among my friends, and I am just so thrilled that he would take time to join us tonight, and that each of you would join us for choir practice. Again, it's an opportunity to get together and kind of talk a little bit about the ugly, laugh a little bit, and then at the end, kind of remind the world that law enforcement really is trying to do things in the right way, and I have great faith in the majority of those and in a system that allows us to fix when the problem children are out there. So, John, thank you so much. I just wish you the very best. And I have to ask you this, will you come back?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Anytime, Mike. I've always appreciated our talks. This feels like just a natural extension of that, but it's got the added benefit of we've got so many great supporters that are here joining in on the conversation with us as well. So absolutely. I'll be back. Plus, you're going to be over on my channel. We got all kinds of work to do, Mike.
Well, I'm looking forward to that.
All right.
And I'm thrilled that the book finally showed up there. So I'm looking forward to your critique. And I expect a full critique. And to all of you wonderful folks who wished happy birthdays and all these wonderful remarks, including those who said that John's the king of true crime, you kind of took a little wind out of my sail. But to all of you, I want to just thank you so much. We really do appreciate not only your friendship, but the collaboration that we have as a group and the clean manner in which you keep the conversations in the chat. It really is appreciated. To the mods, thank you so much. And again, John, thank you. And to everybody, have a great night.
You got it.
And there's your back office, folks.